I'm going to stand. If you'd like to stand, please do. If you'd rather sit or kneel or whatever you'd like to do, obviously feel free to do that. God, we praise you. God, we worship you. You're worthy of glory and honor. All praise is due your name. God, this morning we praise you for your love, which is everlasting. Your faithfulness, which never ends. Not even when our faithfulness falls apart. When we're living in infidelity of our own lives, we let pride get in the way. We think we've got it all figured out. But you come in, you break down the walls. You reveal yourself to us again, and again and again. God, thank you for new life. God, thank you for forgiveness. Sing to you, God, this morning. Thank you, God, for love and life. We thank you for peace and for mercy. And God, for working in us, Lord, and transforming our world, and the world around us, through us, and even in spite of us, God. Thank you. Lift up the name of Jesus. God in my waking, You are everything, God, so be our everything. We trust in you, God, this morning. Again, we just give ourselves to you this morning in joy. Or maybe in brokenness this morning, maybe we're facing that. In whatever way we're coming this morning, offer ourselves to you. Whether it's broken and laying on the floor, figuratively, or it's on cloud nine, it's floating in joy and peace and prosperity, and whatever in between maybe we are, God, we just come to you. And we know that you are God no matter our circumstance, no matter the situation, and God, you give us victory. And you give us life and life in abundance. And we thank you for that promise this morning, all those promises, for you know all your promises in your word are yes and amen through Jesus Christ. This morning we just, again, thank you, God. We open ourselves to receive from you, from your word, from one another, in this time, in Jesus' name. Say it's amazing. The Boston Fowl, you know, there are some mornings where we have more children than adults. In fact, I think that's the case this morning, correct? We have more children than adults, or a little bit. Okay. Yeah, so it's fun because we have the joy of children, right? And their energy and their noise and other things that they bring, but they bring a lot of good things. And I think it's amazing as I've known, well, four of these are mine, but I've known the children and seeing them as they come each Sunday morning, how they grow. And how they do express that joy in their lives. It's just awesome. Of course, they also express frustration too, but that's a whole other story for another time. But this morning, I just want to take again just a moment to pray. And also just a reminder of a couple things coming up here at Lost and Found, kind of announcements, wave announcements here. Again, our community meal that we mentioned earlier, the last Sunday of February 26th, right after our gathering here, and then after that will be our monthly planning meeting. The next, for then March, then our planning meeting will be the third Sunday of the month instead of the fourth. So that's, will be all on Facebook and our website and different things like that. We do some volunteering coming up in March. I also would really like to get this idea, and I have it, there's some sheets in the back. I've got a sheet here I'm looking off of announcements you can find in the back, but I really want to do this date night free babysitting event. I really want to make that happen. We'll see what happens if we can get some college students to help. But just to provide for any families we know that have little kids that maybe need babysitting, we want a date night to get away from the craziness, as I was talking about children already. Maybe have their moments. So that's just an idea I have for later in March. So just a few things going on. You guys can keep up with that on Facebook and the website and email and whatnot. Yeah, so that's that. Yes, we're safe. Yeah, that's kind of the idea. And again, I know we'll have some issues with, I guess it's the issue of liability. I don't know how, I guess it's we're inviting people. It's like they take the service however they want to do it. If they just know that us, you know, the people that are doing it, you know what I mean? Yeah, that might be a good idea. I have like a plan, and we'll have a kind of, what I envision is, we'll have a plan night of like activities in the space here, like, you know, games and stuff, and snacks, you know, kind of plan it out, you know, dietary stuff and all that, but all that kind of thing here, so parents can go downtown, they can go wherever, but yeah, I need to get on that, but that's kind of what I see as, I see it as an outreach. We talked about this last week, it's over there, but kind of an outreach slash kind of a benefit to our community as well, so it's not just, like, the parents that have kids are babysitting, like, we're actually going out too. So it's like we're finding people who don't have kids to watch the kids, and then even people in the church can go out and have a date night. That's kind of the idea. So I got to do some recruiting with our young adults and other people. And then find other people too that would be interested in helping, even in other groups. So, yeah, so that's that. So, kind of a way of getting people involved to use their gifts of serving children, and then also gives a break for the parents. So, thanks, Mercedes, for mentioning that. If anybody wants to help plan that with me, I'd be glad to help.
Also,
Prince
went ice skating for the
26th. Yep. Yes, I have that in here, but we'll put that on here. So that'll be after the planning meeting, right? So
right.
Dinner, it'll be lunch, planning meeting, and then ice skating.
Yes.
Perfect. Alright. I'll try not to be too heavy on the announcements this morning. So, again, for our prayer request, I did kind of make an offering, just, you know, a little more specific prayer, I guess, than I was planning earlier, but just remember these things that we asked for prayer for. He goes, just remember the things that we're praying for throughout the week. And I guess I'll just highlight that we do send emails out. And those, thank you, Mercedes, for doing that, for making that happen. It's awesome. So we're going to get those emails out every week. People are praying for those things. Also, let people know they think would be willing to pray. They don't have to be a part of this group, but they're like home church, different places you've been. You feel like kind of prayer warriors. You feel like they want to support this. Have them at it. You know, you can send them a link to our website. They can sign up for the prayer email there, too. But just want to get, I would like to see by the summer, I've set this goal a couple times, but I'd like to see us get to at least 100 people on our prayer list. Right now, we're, I think, at 79. So we have an actual goal. There's 21. If my math is right, is that right? Yeah. 21 more people to add to the list to get 100. And I think that would just be awesome. Just having more people praying is good. Even if it's one more person praying, that would be helpful. So just remember, again, Justin and Eden, Landon, from Melissa and Zach and Isabel, for Nathaniel's birthday, Sadie's friend's uncle, cousin and mom, Savannah's friend's mom, for a cancer situation, pray for the church, Brenda's work situation, for the Standing in the Gap retreat. Those are all things that are on our hearts, so let's just remember those in prayer throughout the week, not just here on a Sunday morning. All right. With that, I'm going to move into our message this morning. So if you guys have Bibles on your phone, there's some on the back table if you need one. I'm going to get right into this morning. Continuing the series on building the foundation, that's been our theme since January 29th, and we've got a couple more weeks, two more weeks of this series. I'm building the foundation. This is was planned specifically aimed towards this church community as a community. But I believe that these are transferable lessons. You can take them other places. These are things that are not just for this church, but I'm kind of aiming it this way. That makes sense. So this is kind of helping us as a group, whether we're seeing it on a Facebook Live or here in person, hearing these messages. That's going to help us kind of get on the same page. That's kind of my theme this year as a whole, as this church. And all that it entails, our college ministry, our outreaches, us as people, let's get on the same page. I got a hula hoop, apparently. let's get on the same page and let's get some very practical things down. And understand things together, kind of be on the same page as far as what we're doing, why we're doing it, those kind of things. So our planning meetings every month, those have to do with that too, that we're meeting regularly. Before we were meeting maybe once or maybe twice a year to plan things for the church. Now we're meeting once a month to do like business stuff. You know, do planning outreaches, events, those kind of things. So that's a part of that, too. So you kind of see that we're doing all this to get a little more on the same page. So this morning, we're going to be talking about making others feel welcome. Making others feel welcome. Building a foundation. There are two parts to this message. So, two parts. Now, does anybody remember what we've talked about over the last couple weeks? As far as kind of our building the foundation. What were some of the themes or things we discussed? I'll say some of it is displayed in the room, so you can kind of see it. Yep, a church should look like. Okay, yep. What was that, Brian? I thought you said something else, too.
Where the church has been.
Yep. So there are poster boards over here. And where we've been over our history, which is the right orange poster board, and then the left one is from last year. Kind of what has God done in and through us? That's where the poster boards are. That was like our first one, right? we talked last week about this one, which I know a few folks were here. We talked about serving our surrounding area. We kind of brought the question, like, what a perfect church. If you're finding your perfect church, we're going to talk about what this is. I know perfect church is perfect, but if you're looking for a perfect church, how would they serve their surrounding community? That's how I kind of posed the question. And we gave some ideas. Wrote them down on sticky notes. And then I said, well, we focus a lot on this. Again, for those that weren't here last week. Just a reminder for those that were. I said we're really good at focusing on this side of things. Like here, we can serve our area, our local community. Like we talked about, you know, we said serving at the animal shelter, buying school supplies, volunteering at the homeless shelter, spending time building relationships with those less noticed or fortunate, serving at the food pantry, fundraisers for various things, clothing drives, again serving time. We talked a lot about this, like doing these things. I said, what about this side? What about serving one another? Because we looked back in the book of Acts, we saw that the early church spent a lot of time together. They had meals together. They prayed for one another. They learned together. Sometimes I think we can get so focused on, well, the church is supposed to serve other people, yet we neglect one another, and we don't get to know each other to know what our needs are. And so I put out on the, we talked about a few things. Babysitting. Like just helping make time for other people so they can do things that are important to them. Making meals for people when they're in the hospital. Maybe it's just mentoring somebody or discipling somebody. Spending more time with them. And so those are some of the things we said we can do as a group. And I forgot the week before that we talked about is getting to know each other better as a whole. Okay, too. We spent time in conversation kind of around the tables. We had snacks and whatnot. We were just kind of like gathering around the table like the early church did, having meals together. So this week we're going to talk about kind of a little more external, as we did on the left side of our board over there. And so I said my original plan or title was Making Others Feel Welcome, but I do want to do two parts. We're going to read two rather long passages of Scripture to kind of bring these ideas out. So I'm going to flip to John chapter 4. And again, this is probably a familiar passage if you've been around the church for any length of time. And a very powerful passage at that, because it has so much that we could preach a whole series on this passage. But I want to bring out just a couple elements of it. So we're going to read two passages. One's related to one element of welcoming, and the other parts together. John chapter 4, verses 1 through 42. John chapter 4, verses 1 through 42. I mean, this passage has a lot to it. We're just going to read it. I want you to kind of listen to what's being said. Well, listen to what's happening here and try to pull out from it what you can. Kind of pay attention. What is God speaking to you? I'm going to start in verse 1. If somebody else wants to volunteer to pick up, maybe a couple people will be willing as I stop. Other people can read. I'm just going to read a few verses and we get a couple more volunteers. It's already a good passage of it, or portion of it. But I'm going to read in John chapter 4. Verses 1 through 42. Just follow along and when I stop, so you guys can pick it up. All right, John chapter 4, starting in verse 1. It says, "Now Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, 'Will you give me a drink?' His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, 'You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans.' Jesus answered her, 'If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, and did also his sons and his livestock?'" Or as did, excuse me. "Jesus answered, 'Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life.' The woman said to him, 'Sir, give me this water so that I won't go thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water.'" So I just want to pick up there.
"He told her, 'Go call your husband and come back. I have no husband,' she replied. Jesus said to her, 'You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you have had 5 husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem.' 'Woman,' Jesus replied, 'believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in the truth.' The woman said, 'I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us.' Then Jesus declared, 'I, the one speaking to you, I am he.'"
Then Jesus' disciples arrived and were shocked that he was talking. Sychar and went into the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who has told me everything I've done. Could this man be the Christ?" They left the city and were on their way to see Jesus. In the meantime, the disciples spoke to Jesus, saying, "Rabbi, eat." Jesus said to them, "I have food to eat that you don't know about." The disciples asked each other, "Has someone brought him food?" Jesus said to them, "I am fed by doing the will of the one who sent me and by completing his work. Don't you have a saying, 4 more months and then it's time for the harvest? Look, I tell you, open your eyes and notice that the fields are already ripe for the harvest. Those who harvest are receiving their pay and gathering fruit for eternal life. But those who sow and those who harvest can celebrate together. This is a true saying that one who sows and another harvests. I have sent you to harvest what you didn't work hard for. Others worked hard for, and you will share in their hard work." Many Samaritans in the city believed in Jesus because of the woman's word when she testified, "He has told me everything I've ever done." So when the Samaritans came to Jesus, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days. Many more believed because of his word. And they said to the woman, "We no longer believe because of what you said, but we have heard ourselves and know that this one is truly the Savior of the world."
Yeah, kind of a long passage. But you kind of see the dynamics here of Jesus, his interaction with other people. And you love how Jesus functioned. He was always, like, obviously above and beyond, like, everyone's understanding. Like, they just were, like, doing their own thing. They kind of were living their life. And Jesus has the bigger picture, right? He's speaking to something bigger than what they can picture, what they're thinking about. Jesus traveling back to Galilee from Judea and from the south and north, walking, which I always love when we read these. It seems like it's just, oh, Jesus flippantly walked. I mean, it's a long way. That's a long way he had to go. He's traveling a distance. He has to travel through Samaria. And if you don't know much about Samaria, there's a place that the Jewish people considered kind of foreign territory. They didn't like the people that were there. They didn't like Samaritans. Samaritans are kind of a half-breed, half-Jewish, half-something else. To them, it was like they're like dogs are worse. Like, they're not good. We don't spend time with them. But what does Jesus do? Jesus doesn't just show up, take some water, and get out of there. Jesus does what? He spends time. And not only does he spend time, he spends time with, again, another thing in that culture would be kind of awkward, is that a rabbi, a male, spending time with a woman, quasi alone. Jesus breaks these barriers down, spends time with this woman, who then we find out later on has had multiple marriages, she's not with the guy she's with right now, technically. And so even more so, Jesus is going way beyond what anyone ever would think he would ever do. This great religious man who's really pure, Jesus demonstrates, and he is God, and he shows us what God is like. And so we get this Jesus going, and you see this kind of dynamic that's going on, this tension. Even the woman says, "Why are you talking to me? Like, it shouldn't be happening. This is really weird," right? Even she recognizes there's a problem here of culture, of societal, you know, norms. And yet Jesus does what? He spends time with her, and he talks with her. And he has a conversation about water, which was relating with where she was. But yet you see how he takes this idea of water, and he moves it into more of a spiritual, bigger picture thing. She goes into what her history was. Probably has some, maybe some bad, you know, like, connotations about who she is. She's had all these husbands. You know, she's not with her husband right now. This guy is not really her husband. She goes back into town, and she does what? She starts telling people about Jesus, right? No matter maybe the shame that she's experienced, no matter what she's been through, she's been impacted. She only this little bit about Jesus. She hasn't heard all the gospel, all these things. She thought just what Jesus has shared with her, she's going to go back and tell everybody about it. So now, not only has Jesus invited her into the story and invited her deeper, now she's going to share it with other people that know her. And maybe even though she has a bad relationship with them, they think maybe she's kind of a little bit on the outside, she's going in and she's reaching out. She's going to build a relationship. That's what Jesus does. When you experience Jesus, you share with other people. If you've truly been changed by the Lord, you have something to share with somebody else. Isn't that amazing, her joy that she brings? She's like, maybe some of us have heard these messages. We've been set free of bondages and sin and shame. We've had these amazing sermons we've heard. We've experienced the Holy Spirit. We're like, and we just get on fire. She has heard about Jesus saying, like, just, you know, worshipers, you know, true worshipers will worship the Lord in spirit and truth. I'm going to give you this water. I mean, like, just these basic things. And he says, "I'm the Christ." And she goes and shares. And what do? They believe, right? Now this woman invited them. And then after Jesus speaks to them, this last part, I love verse 42. I want to go all the way to the end because I think it's amazing. Because now the woman invited them in relationship. She shared what she heard from Jesus. But they actually said, okay, we'll go with this. We'll go and hear what this is all about. Verse 42, it says, they said to the woman, we no longer believe just because of what you said. The relationship you built with us, the time you spent telling us about what happened. But now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world. I love that. See, the people could have just heard the woman speak, you know. We can tell people all about what we know about Jesus. And they can hear all our great arguments and all of our great experiences, but until they actually come and they say, okay, I'm going to seek this out for myself, and they experience the Lord, right? They believed in him because of her testimony, but that's the big step, right? For someone to go from being in a relationship with somebody else who knows the Lord to actually saying, I'm going to take a step myself. And that's what we hope would happen, right? Whenever we share the gospel with our own lives, when we talk to our friend about Jesus, we spend time sharing our testimony with someone, we hope that they will go from just saying, oh, that's awesome. That's great, Mercedes, that God is doing great things in your life, and you share all these great things on Facebook, which I love what you share. You have all these great things. God's, you know, just bringing joy in my life and these great things. But for someone, wouldn't it be awesome if someone said, okay, I actually stepped out for myself and said, I want to find out. Now I know Jesus. Right? This whole story of Jesus, though, there's so much here. And again, you know, we could preach a series on this. All these things that Jesus, I mean, even just on the part of, you know, it sounds confusing. Verse 23, yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. That's a loaded passage. Just right there we could talk about. But I brought out some of the points I wanted you to hear here, that Jesus went to kind of a foreign place, the place that, you know, most Jewish people kind of avoid. That we actually, a lot, they would go around the area. They'd spend a lot of time on foot or on camels or whatever, going around that location where those people were, but Jesus went straight through it, and he spent time. And he didn't only spend time, he took time, and he invested in someone, and he invited them out to hear more about himself and about what God was doing. And then because of that, the whole community was impacted. All right, so that's the first passage. So that brings me to this first element. When we're talking about building the foundation of a church, it starts with, and this is all going to sound probably pretty basic, but it starts with inviting. Now I'm not talking about, when I say building the foundation of a church, it's not about this Sunday morning gathering, about building a great group, like, okay, Lost and Found, we want to get bigger, or whatever your home church is. I'm talking about the church as the kingdom of God, doing God's will. To be a part of kingdom building, which Lost and Found Church, we say we are, and making other people feel welcome, it starts by an invitation. I mean, it's pretty basic. The question to me is, if people are not invited, will they come? Will they be a part of, will they engage with the church? Now, I've heard of some pretty awesome supernatural things where people have seen, like, visions of Jesus, and, like, Jesus said, you need to go to this church, like, you need to, I mean, like, in the Middle East and things like that, and it's pretty awesome. I've heard a few of those different stories. It's pretty amazing. But generally how I see God working is, it's through relationship. There's sometimes, or other times, maybe someone will pick up a gospel tract, and like that will kind of be the invitation for them to come and seek out Jesus more. But I think most of the time, most of our experiences probably in growing in the Lord and coming to be a part of a church community is through a relationship. It's being invited by someone else, right? So if you're not invited, most likely you're probably not going to come. It's just pretty basic, right? Like people come, you know, if there's a birthday and there's a birthday party, people show up because why? Because they're invited, right? And this is pretty basic stuff. In dating relationships, those relationships start forming because someone's invited to, like, say, hey, I'm gonna go get some food. Like, you're gonna invite somebody to come, right? Let's go get some. Otherwise, there's nothing that really happens, right? If you don't invite someone into this kind of circle of yours, they're probably not gonna come. You think about Jesus. Jesus invited the disciples when he saw them on the lake fishing, right? Jesus saw them in the boats. He said, come and follow me. It was an invitation. A deeper invitation than those that would follow. Many followed Jesus. They saw him, and they would just follow him around. But there are many, we read in the Gospel of John, that followed him because of his miracles, because they got something from it. And a lot of those people fell away. But Jesus invited people to come follow him. So part of building the foundation, making others feel welcome, building the church, building these communities, church community is to inviting other people. But the question I have is then, what are we inviting them to in this context of the church, right? What are we inviting people to? Well, number one, as I've said a couple times or alluded to, is a relationship. When you're talking to somebody about Jesus, or you're seeking to help invite someone into the church community, into what you've experienced, into the life that God has given to them and to you, into the gospel, truth, however you want to put it, you're inviting them into relationship. We've got to understand that. We're not inviting them just to acknowledge some truth. Like, hey, just say you believe this. That's not what the church is. That's not how it works. A lot of people, we function that way. As long as you believe certain things, okay, hey, here's a list of things, just sign this, right? We don't maybe do it that way, but believe all these things and then you're in, right? That's not what it's all about. To be a welcoming and a growing church community is not to say, here's a list of truths you need to believe. You're inviting them to a relationship, right? And not just a relationship, but it's specifically a relationship with you. Right? So when I'm going to go share what Jesus has done in my life, the gospel, something, I'm inviting them to a relationship with myself, with who I am, my personality, right? My interests. You're going to try to build relationships. So it's with you. It's with other people, too. When you're inviting someone into, and if we're talking specifically here about this church community, you're inviting them into this group, right? So realize that. You're inviting people into this community, to our quirks and our interests and the people that are here. If you're inviting someone into, to the truth of God's word, into the gospel, what that means, you're also inviting someone into a relationship with Jesus, obviously. But also you're inviting people into a new way of thinking, a new environment as well. You've got to think about this. A church that's growing is an inviting church. It's one that's sharing relationship with other people. It's not just saying, here's a program, come to it, and believing these things. It's a relationship. So that's why I emphasize that. It's a relationship with you, with other people, with Jesus, with a new way of thinking, a new environment. And this is different. Coming on a Sunday morning, every church is different. I mean, we've all been to different churches. Even this, when you're inviting someone to come be a part of something, maybe you're inviting to a Sunday morning gathering or to a game night or to a gap for a college ministry. You're inviting them, if that's an avenue you're using to help them get connected, you're inviting them to something that maybe is really weird. Like, I don't know anybody here, right? That's awkward. That's really hard. Think about that when you're inviting someone to the room. I mean, what does that look like? You have new people, not a familiar place. Maybe people are speaking a different language, so to speak. Like, we're talking about weird things you don't understand. Discussion. I believe if we're going to be a church that's truly growing and truly fulfilling our mission, we need to be inviting. That's number one. Inviting with relationship with others. Recognizing that when we do that, it can be a little bit uncomfortable, it can be a little weird. I mean, if we're talking about here specifically, Sunday morning, walking through the door, okay, there's a chalk wall, weird thing, there's all these kids running around, like, I don't know anybody, if I didn't know anybody, that can be uncomfortable. Or even people who maybe come checking it out, coming to this just as a gathering, let alone as a game night or something where it's more relationship building. So that's the second part, welcoming other people. So we're talking about two things this morning, being inviting and being welcoming. Let's flip to Acts chapter 15. So what do we do when people are looking for a church community? We're inviting people in. We're saying, hey, friend of mine. Hey, classmate. Hey, roommate. I want to share about Jesus, what he's done in my life with you. And I really would encourage you to come and I'd love you to come check out Gap. Check out this local church community. Check out this game night thing we're doing. We want to make sure people feel that they're welcome. They're actually included. I'm going to read Acts chapter 15. Again, this is another passage that could be a whole series. Acts chapter 15, starting in verse 1, going through verse 35. Acts chapter 15, starting in verse 1, going through verse 35. Okay, now listen to the story. Right? This is now the early church. And the early church is trying to, trying to figure out some difficult situations. In case you didn't realize that, we talked earlier about looking for a perfect church. Now, if there ever was a perfect church, I think it'd be like the first one, right? Because they couldn't have any problems, they couldn't mess anything up. But it was, pretty quickly that they found there were problems. And they tried to figure out how to do things. Are there any wrong beliefs? Like, how do we work with these people who are kind of outside of our normal group? Jews and non-Jews. Because if you don't know, the early church was predominantly or all Jewish people. But there are people, we already talked about this, but Jesus was about not just Jewish people, but all people. And so they had to deal with that. How do you now start including people that are not a part of your normal kind of circle, right? Like, okay, I'm used to this group right here. This is my circle. How do I kind of be okay with, and maybe not only be okay with, but include them? We don't have that problem today, but that was an issue back then. So we're going to read about it. Excerpt of 15, starting in verse 1. It says, certain people came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the believers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. Okay, so if you don't do this Jewish practice, you're not saved. All right? This brought Paul and Barnabas into sharp dispute and debate with them. So Paul and Barnabas were appointed, along with some of other believers, to go up to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this question. The church sent them on their way, and as they traveled through Phoenicia and Samaria, they told how the Gentiles had been converted. Now, just a second here. I just want to point out, where was Jesus in our last passage?
Samaria.
All right. Now, Paul and Barnabas traveling, right? To this area that, even up to that point, you'll find out later, they were still kind of having issues with, like, how do we share God's good news with these, you know, half-breed people? You know, but Jesus did, right? Jesus went out into Samaria, but yeah, they're still having issues. So this is emphasized here. The church sent them on their way, and as they traveled through Phoenicia and Samaria, so they didn't go around, they went through this area that was still kind of an awkward place to go through, they told how the Gentiles had been converted. So Gentiles are non-Jewish people. Like the, so people that were there. This news made all the believers very glad. When they came to Jerusalem, they were welcomed by the church and the apostles and elders, to whom they reported everything God had done through them. Then some of the believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees stood up and said, the Gentiles must be circumcised and required to keep the law of Moses. So they need to basically be, what they're saying is, you need to practice all these other religious practices to be saved, like we do. Verse 6, the apostles and elders met to consider this question. After much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them. Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles might hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe. God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us. He did not discriminate between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of Gentiles a yoke that neither we nor our ancestors have been able to bear? No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved just as they are. Amen. The whole assembly became silent as they listened to Barnabas and Paul telling about the signs and wonders God had done among the Gentiles through them. When they finished, James spoke up. Brothers, he said, listen to me. Simon has described to us how God first intervened to choose a people for his name from the Gentiles. The words of the prophets are in agreement with this, as it is written. After this, I will return and rebuild David's fallen tent. Its ruins I will rebuild, and I will restore it. Then the rest of mankind may seek the Lord, even all the Gentiles who bear my name, says the Lord, who does these things, things known from long ago. Someone want to pick up at verse 19 and read a little bit? 1 through verse 35.
It is my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God. Instead, we should write to them, telling them to abstain from being polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, from the meat of the strangled animals, from blood. For the law of Moses has been preached in every city from the earliest times and is read in the synagogues of every Sabbath. Then the apostles and elders with the whole church decided to choose some of their own men and send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. They chose Judas, called Barsabas, and Silas, men who were leaders among the believers. With them, they sent the following letter.
All right, just 1 second here. So I want you guys to see what's going on here. You can read this in a second. All right, so what's going on, right? There's a division. Right? There are problems in the church, right? Which, again, this doesn't happen today. But back then it happened, so we still have our issues today. There's a division. There's a problem, and they're trying to figure out how to work together. Like, we all believe in Jesus, and we want to include these people who are not like us, okay? Just get that. That's a very general thing. They're people who are outsiders to us. They don't do what we do. They don't live like we do. But we still want to include them. We want to invite them, right? We're talking earlier about inviting. We want to invite them in, but we're trying to figure out, like, what do they need to do? Like, how do we do that and do it right, I guess? And how do we make sure we're all kind of on the same page, as I was talking about earlier? So they talk about, okay, well, here's how we're going to do it. We're not going to make it difficult for them. That's not the way we need to do this. So they are going to write this letter to all these churches, all these people who are not like them, but they're still wanting to invite in. They want them to be a part. They want to welcome them into the church. So what do they say? Go ahead, Mercedes, and go ahead and read the letter there.
With them, they sent the following letter, the apostles and elders to your brothers, to the Gentile believers in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia. Greetings. We have heard that some went out from us without our authorization and disturbed you, troubling your minds by what they said. So we all agreed to choose some men and send them to you with our dear friends, Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, we are sending Judas and Silas to confirm by word of mouth that we are writing. It seems good to the Holy Spirit and to us not to burden you with anything beyond the following requirements. You are to abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, from the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. You will do well to avoid these things. Farewell.
Yeah. I'm going to finish out here, verses 31 through 35. So the men were sent off and went down to Antioch, where they gathered the church together and delivered the letter. So here's the letter. The people read it and were glad for its encouraging message. Judas and Silas, who themselves were prophets, said much to encourage and strengthen the believers. After spending some time there, they were sent off by the believers with the blessing of peace to return to those who had sent them. But Paul and Barnabas remained in Antioch, where they and many others taught and preached the word of God. Or word of the Lord. All right, so here, we're talking about welcoming. This is one of the biggest, like, crazy times in the church, early on. In seminary, different books you read, different places, they talk about this as the Acts 15 Council. So they even use this chapter, they talk about Acts 15 as, like, a pretty major part of the church. Because they could have done it wrong. They could have got it wrong, right? They could have said, like, nope, we got to follow the rules, and then what would have happened? Division, split, people leaving, right? Probably, like, I'm not going to deal with this crap. You know, whatever, I want to put it. Like, if they would have handled it wrong, it could have been a lot of detriment to the early church. I mean, who knows what it would have looked like? But they said it seemed good to us, to the Holy Spirit and to us, which I think is an amazing phrase. They believed, they were confident that God was saying, don't need to follow all these rules. We want you to be a part of this group. Here's some encouragement. These are the things that we think would be just the best. You follow these, and we're good. Glad you're with us, you know, kind of a thing. And I think it's amazing because, again, they could have been prideful. They could have said, hey, these are the things we follow. You need to follow these as well. But they're willing to say, look, we understand where you are. We want you to be a part of this. And this is God's heart in all this anyway. They were able to discern God's will rather than holding on to pride or something else and saying no. So welcoming others. But I realize one basic truth in all this is people who don't feel welcome won't come back. And that's not just related to Sunday mornings. It has to do with friendships, dating relationships, right? If people don't feel welcome, they're not going to come, right? And is that pretty basic? Yeah. So I ask the question, what does it mean to be welcoming? What does it mean to be welcoming? I guess I put it to you, too, because you never know. If you're thinking about being welcoming, if we're talking about coming back now to our church setting, I was looking at the church as a whole, how they kind of dealing with different people coming in, like how do they deal with that? For us as a church community here, what does that look like? What does it mean for us to be welcoming, a welcoming community? We've invited somebody to come in the doors, to come and be a part of this in some way, shape, or form. What does it look like?
Share what we believe, but hearing out what their beliefs are.
Okay. It's like listening. Right, so trying to find mutual ground, mutual interests, or understanding.
Yeah. Trying to, like,
like the idea of like connecting too, and this kind of brings me to a thought about when you think about our church. I brought this up here to kind of remind us of like how lost and found I was over here actually. But I did bring it up originally to kind of talk about, you know, how does it look as far as all of this and how we are welcoming, how we're inviting. Inviting and welcoming all these areas. I mean, space is kind of weird, like how we're building, but like how the community with our children, with college ministry, with camp, with in our giving game church, some of these are more of our outreach things. Because I think that's a good point. You know, if someone walked in the door, for example, that's new, we want to be welcoming, because if you're not welcoming, they usually people don't come back. They're not interested in being a part of it. And it's not just in coming to the space, it's coming to an event, being in a friendship with you, being in a relationship with you. So if you can find mutual interest, and that's what I like about this. This is something that I'm really getting, I mean, honestly, I don't know what God's doing with me right now, but I feel really strongly in this area. That I'm feeling, I want to do more personally. And maybe this is me personally. I'm not saying I'm taking the whole church or gap or whatever this way. But I feel there's something that God's doing here in our games area. We're seeing a lot of stuff happening with reaching out to those that are into gaming, whether it's board, not just video games, board game, card game, that kind of thing. That's a mutual interest. So when people come in, like we had a student who came to Gap on Thursday, and I didn't get a chance to talk to him very much, but I don't know him very well, but I heard him talking about video games. And I'm like, there's just a connection point. We have a lot of guys in Gap that are into video games. And so they all speak that language, right? So they have a mutual interest. So he's going to feel welcome if they start talking about gaming, because they all kind of have a similar interest. And we know that goes with anything. It doesn't have to be games, it could be sports, it could be... But that's a very practical thing. If you can sit down with someone and say, I mean, weather is obviously an easy one, right? Like, everyone can talk about the weather, because we're all dealing with it. But, like, if there's something that we can do to help someone, on top of, obviously, the truth that we're sharing, make them feel welcome, and be genuine about it. If it's our interest, if I'm into gaming, and I find someone else is into gaming, it's going to work. If I'm into soccer, and someone else is into soccer, it's going to be a really easy way to build a relationship, and they're going to feel more welcome, right? So right, so that's a big part of it. Being friendly, showing genuine interest in someone, listening to them, making people feel at home or valued, right? What do they say? There's another way. This is just very practical stuff, but going three questions deep. I've heard of 3 to 5 questions deep. Have you heard that phrase? Like, so you ask a question, they share their answer, and then you ask a question about their answer. Have you ever done that? Like, practice that? It's a really good way of getting to know someone. Like, really be proactive in your listening. So, like, okay, so we're saying Mercedes, like, what are you into, like, music-wise? You can share whatever kind of music. What kind of music are you into right now?
Gospel.
So what kind of gospel music? Like, what specific artists are you into?
I really love Travis Green.
Travis Green, right. There you go. So what song, like, what are his songs like, or what songs do you like about him?
Have you ever heard Intentional? That's one of my favorites.
Sing it for me.
Break it up.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that. That's awesome. I like your singing voices. Right? It's awesome. I love it. You sing sometimes. And that's the thing too, because I am really genuinely interested in that. But I mean, just in general, but that's kind of like going questions deep. Like you go through questions deep, because now I get to know a new song, which is awesome. I think I've actually maybe heard that before too, but like, that's awesome. And so now I learned something, I'm excited about it, but also you get to help someone else kind of share what they're all about too. So that's a very practical thing. So if someone walks in the door at Gap, at the church here in the morning, those are things that help us to engage. So you just ask a question, and then you ask about the answer, and then you can keep going with those questions. And that's not at all fake, obviously, because some people say, well, that's just going to be, no, it's not, because you actually are interested, right? I was getting excited. I could ask more questions about that. Okay, what other songs does he do? Like, because, and that helps for all of us to kind of engage and get to know one another better. What we sometimes do is we block off and say, okay, I'm going to tell you only about me, and then if you don't relate with that person responding to you, you shut it down, and that doesn't really work. So we need to make people feel at home, valued, ask questions, go through questions deep, find mutual interest, whether it's gaming, whatever it may be. That makes it even easier, but even if you're not, it's not a mutual interest, you can find out more about it. Help people, give them directions. Again, that's something here on Sunday morning. I think this is a very practical, getting on the same page thing. If someone comes in that's new or has never been here before, help them find the bathroom. Here's the coffee. Here, you know, those some of those things, like spending time in conversation or a gap. You know, like sit down next to someone and talk to them. I know that's something we've talked about with our college ministry, is help them kind of get to know other people. And if no one else can reach out to them, then you can help them, invite them into a relationship with someone else. Because I think we know what it's like. And I'm going to say maybe rhetorically this question. Have you ever been in a place where you have not felt welcomed? Have you ever been to a church or a party or an event where you're like, I don't feel like I fit here? Just think back to what that was like. Show up, and what usually is like. Here are my examples of what that's like. No one talks to you. Or are you trying to engage in a conversation, and they maybe go like one question deep, and then they just stop, and they turn to something else? Don't feel super welcome. Like, if you try to put energy out to engage, which some people don't, I mean, they got to recognize that too. Some people are just uncomfortable. So if I'm fairly extroverted sometimes. So if I show up and I put energy out in an uncomfortable situation and I get no reciprocation, probably not going to feel welcome. And what's going to happen? Probably not going to go back. If people don't feel welcome, they're probably not going to come back. And not, again, I'm going to say it again, that's not just with church, that's Sunday morning, that's with anything. So you can relate to what it feels like to not be welcomed. So I would say, to get on the same page, do the opposite of that. When you meet other people who are new, or who are checking things out, we've invited in, or someone else has invited in. I can spend more time on this, but we're going super long now, so I'm going to stop here. But what does it take to be inviting and to be welcoming? I'm just going to put it at that very basic level. What does it take to be inviting and to be welcoming? I think it's the same for both. It takes another person, at least one other person. So as you, it takes another person you can talk to, right? So if it's inviting someone, it's someone you know. If it's welcoming someone, it's someone that's coming in the door or coming to an event or that you just met for the first time. It takes a form of communication, so it's talking to them. Maybe it could be even online. It could be, I mean, just some form of communication. Usually it's going to be in person. So if it's inviting someone, it's like, I'm talking to you. I'm texting you too, possibly. It's welcoming someone. It's actually walking up to them and saying, hey, you know, I'm going to talk to you in time. It takes time. And that's it. To be inviting and welcoming just takes another person, at least one other person. It takes some form of communication. You're just going to be just talking to them in time. And we have all of those. Not too complicated. That's what I'm trying to say. It's not complicated. But I think on top of that, maybe to bring that all together, it takes a little boldness. We've not been given a spirit of fear. I think it's in the Bible somewhere, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Amen? Yeah. We have been given the Holy Spirit. He gives us the words to speak. We've been given the truth to share. So if we have another person in our life, we have some way of communicating, which we all can, except for all you guys speak and talk, and we have time, we can do this. But I believe that's what it's going to take to see, as part of our growing this church, and being a part of a growing church, is to be inviting and welcoming. We see it in the early church, we see it with Jesus, inviting people, being willing to be around other people, even when we're different. We see it in Acts 15, the willingness to welcome other people into the community. So my challenge is this, to make this church community more inviting and more welcoming. That's my challenge. That's what I want. I think that's more of a goal, I should say. So we need to consciously put into practice some new ways of inviting or welcoming people this year. Maybe it's welcoming somebody at the door. Maybe it's making a friend with someone else is invited. Like, so you see that Brendan Randall brought somebody in that's new. Hey, I'll talk to you. Or Savannah came in. Hey, Savannah, there. Building a relationship. New people that are coming in, obviously. And that's just something we should be doing naturally. In whatever part of this that we're in. Meeting and inviting a new person to your house, to a church gathering, to a Sunday morning. It's not just here. But people, folks, that's how I see our way forward. If we want to see this church grow, we need to be inviting and welcoming, or otherwise we're just going to, I don't think we are going to, personally. Let's just stop being honest. I don't see how we can. So with that, let me pray, and we'll close it down. Actually, we're going to sing a song at the end. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, for your word, and a lot of it that we get to read this morning together. And a lot of time spent in your word, and just hearing and talking about it. Lord, I invite you, Lord, to come and speak to us in new ways, give us new boldness and fresh vision for this church, and not only for this church community, but for us as individuals as we go. And maybe we have other home churches or other ministries that we're a part of. And that you would send us forth with new understanding this morning, and you give us boldness to take time and use our form of communication, whatever it may be, to reach another person, to invite them into this work that you're doing in our lives and in the church, or to welcome someone else as you see them coming in and checking things out, trying to find their place. How would you make Lost and Found Church through us, direct us, and would you make it more of a welcoming, inviting place as we continue to grow? In Jesus' name. So sing Teresa's prayer. It's the last song on your sheet this morning. Thank you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face to you all and give you peace. Amen.
So I think we have our main